Clayton.
Hey, how are you?
Doing great, thank you.
Yeah. You're stronger than I am. I can't even see anything in the ground. Good job.
Custom battle in my house.
I know the feeling.
Public service is a noble calling, and I still feel that way. End of quote. I want to feel that way again myself, and that's why I'm running for commissioner. I want to restore my own faith in our government and your faith in our government, too. I have long served my community in many facets. For decades, I've served on many boards, different committees in public education, in park and recreation, in the chamber, in my rotary, and in my church. If there was a job to do, I tried to do it, and I tried to do it well. I've taught my two daughters to give back to their community, just as my grandmother and my parents taught me. I have fought diligently in my district against government intrusion with both the land use map and the LYHCP. When the Board of Commissioners threatened to do away with Central Park, a tiny group of us organized hundreds to stand strong, and thank goodness we prevailed. My work in real estate, trucking, and as the general manager of Lanier Lane Music Park have all laid the foundation for a better understanding of working for the public and hopefully being able to make a county government that works for you as well. I have a vision for decreasing bureaucracy and wasteful spending while raising revenues and utilizing our greatest assets, which does not equate to raising your taxes. I want to be your representative. A true public servant that strives to do what's right for her community with both transparency and input from you, the taxpayer. Restore our faith in government by voting for Cindy as your new commissioner. We can do this together. I'm counting on you.
Thank you. Our next candidate is Charles Meagher.
Thank you, Ethan, and thanks to the Republican Party for hosting this debate. Thank you, audience, for being here. It's a nice evening now. I know you have other things to do. I really appreciate you showing up. I hope this evening will be useful to you to help sort out this diverse group of candidates up here. To that end, this is a brief outline of my credentials. I've demonstrated leadership across a broad spectrum of endeavors. I have 39 years in education as a teacher, an assistant principal, a principal, and a central office administrator. My last assignment was as the athletic director, director of community schools and student activities for Gwinnett County Public Schools. These years of leadership have afforded me great insight into problem solving and negotiating solutions. Over those 39 years, I also learned that an effective leader is the person who listens and responds to the concerns of those he represents. I have experience as an elected official and served two terms in the Duluth City Council. I believe in limited government. I believe that government should serve us, not the other way around. As a commissioner, I will work to reduce our local government's negative impact on us. I believe in service to our nation and to our community. Currently serve on the county's board of tax assessors. And as you know, the board's purpose is to set value, not to set taxes. I'm a member of Cumming First United Methodist Church, served on the church administrative board. I currently serve as a trustee for the chapel at Ball Ridge Marina and hope to see you there this Sunday through Labor Day at 9 o'clock on Sundays. I'm retired from the Army National Guard after 23 years of service. Those of you who served in the military or who have hired former military know of their exceptional work ethic, loyalty, and sense of duty. I hope you'll recognize those qualities in the upcoming weeks. Thank you.
Our next candidate is Mr. Bill Mulrooney.
Good evening. My name is Bill Mulrooney. My wife and I grew up in Gwinnett County. We moved here in 2000. For anyone interested in learning more about me, please visit my website, BillMulrooney.com. More than anyone else sitting here, I use my site as a place where people can learn my opinions and ideas on subjects that matter to this county. There are four main points I want to stress tonight. First, the homeowners of District 4 need responsible and ethical representation on the Board of Commissioners. District 4 residents are pretty used to being treated with little respect, ignored, or outright lied to. That is going to change. We need to put ethics back into our government. As Commissioner, District 4 homeowners will know that I will be their champion. Second, we need jobs. We have to get out of this mindset that we are simply a bedroom community. Retail jobs do not equal economic growth. Retail is a byproduct of growth. It is not the creator of it. We need to take responsibility for our own future, and we need to attract employers that offer living wages and benefits. Forsyth County needs to be competitive in attracting new jobs, and we can start by eliminating the inventory tax on business. Third, Forsyth County needs to be water independent. The tail has wagged the dog for too long. We need to partner with our state and federal reps, and we need to obtain our own straw. And fourth, we need to be fiscally responsible. In the past decade, voters have approved $300 million in sales tax for capital improvement projects. The challenge the next board faces will be how to meet these goals and still keep spending down. It won't be easy, but I believe we can do it, because quite frankly, we don't have a choice. Homeowners simply cannot afford to give up any more money. If tonight you don't get all of your questions answered, again, my website's BillMulrooney.com. Drop me an email, give me a call. As I said from the very beginning of my campaign, win or lose, it will not be because people don't know where I stand on issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Ethan. My name is Patrick Bell. Thank you, GOP, for having this function. Thank you guys for coming out tonight. I am the current District 4 Commissioner, Vice Chairman of the Board of Commissioners. My re-election campaign is built on results. It's not built on empty campaign promises, rhetoric, sound bites. It's built on results. I have a track record of verifiable results. I ran for office in 2009 as a political outsider with one goal. That was to make Forsyth County a better place for our children and grandchildren. And in 3.5 years, I'm proud of what's been accomplished on the board. And I'm running for re-election to continue what I've already started. In my first year in office, I worked hard to reduce 25% of the budget. I cut over $20 million from that budget in the first year. I reduced the size of government, I've eliminated wasteful spending, I have fought bureaucracy, and I've balanced the budget without raising taxes. Families and businesses have been tightening their belt. We've done it too. The key to Forsyth County's future is the job market. I created the 400 North Opportunity Zone because I believe that we need to encourage businesses to come to Forsyth County. I've done what my opponents are saying they want to do. I want to create a business environment that welcomes businesses to come to Forsyth County, to invest in our community. We need to be pro-business, pro-growth. And finally, we must put an end to burdensome and intrusive government. I've been fighting for property rights in District 4 and all over Forsyth County for 3.5 years, and I'm not going to stop now. There's been questions about condemnation. There's been questions about the UDC. I'm going to tell you, I'm a representative of the taxpayers and the citizens, and I'll continue to fight for your property rights. I look forward to speaking a little bit more in detail and telling you a little bit more about my future and my vision for the future of Forsyth County. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Tim Hubbard, and I want to thank you all for coming out. Thank you all for giving us this opportunity to share our outlook and our goals for Forsyth County. I'd like to start out with all I love Forsyth County. I've loved Forsyth County all my life, even in a day when folks used to peel Forsyth off of their tags. I never peeled it up because I was proud of Forsyth County. A lot of you know what I'm talking about. I've been here all my life, and I want to see Forsyth County continue to grow and to prosper and be a place where folks are proud to bring their children, folks are proud to come and to raise a family, and just live and enjoy life. I've enjoyed life here. I've been blessed to have a business that my grandfather started, and I worked with Daddy, then I started my own, and I've been able to, you know, in these economic times, still been able to keep my head above water. And I want to see the county to start cutting their budgets, and let's start trimming before we get in bad shape. I realize we're in decent shape now, but, you know, if we keep going the way that we're going, we're not always going to be there, and I'd like to get a hold on it now. By reducing taxes, reducing the budgets across the board, and getting a hold and restoring ethics to the county commissions, and being able to have things open and to everybody, where everybody can see. I'd like to see the all budgets, be able to see them viewed online, where you'd know where your dollars have went to. I don't see nothing wrong with that, because somebody's keeping up with it. I don't see why it'd be hard to put it online for citizens to view. I believe that'd be a good thing for everybody, because I feel better if I know where the money went instead of wondering, did it go there or did it not? I see so-and-so in a brand new vehicle or so-and-so in this, and where did the money go? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mayor Call, if you're here at the first, for the first debate, I will give a quick rundown of the rules. Each candidate for following phase will have 1 minute to respond to the question. We'll go round robin, and then we'll come back around. So each candidate will get a total of 2 minutes, but the intent is to create a dialogue and to respond to your opponent's comments. My friend Joel Natt is sitting down front. He'll be minding the clock. Please keep an eye on him, and please be sure to be mindful of the time that you can give. Our first question, which we begin with Ms. Mills. What can be done to improve transportation within Forsyth County?
I think we have a great transportation department and staff that has a transportation plan that I think by watching it, we've tried to adhere to. I think that we have had a lot of different projects that have been, funds have been allocated within our SPLOST. Where I live in District 4, we're seeing intersection improvements. I think some people question how items get put on a SPLOST list and how those transportation projects are come up with. And I think that, I know that there are steps and procedures in place, but at the same time, I think we could do better getting community input and striving to have, listening to the community about where they see areas of great transportation concern and dangerous intersections.
Mr. Meagher?
Thank you.
somewhere, somehow, there's got to be ability to communicate with the state and the city and the county to get the red lights synchronized. We've had that problem for many years in this county, and I personally have called the various places to say, this is wrong over here, and I've been told, well, that's the issue of this other government, you need to work with them, or we can't do anything about that because it's the state's problem. Working within our particular district, we can find those areas that do need improvement, the intersections that do need improvement, and we can get the priority list through our transportation department to build on it one by one, step by step, to make the improvements that we need. Thank you.
Mr. Morgan.
Well, I'll tell you how you don't do it. T-splossed. Don't do it. That won't do a thing for our traffic. You know, here's the thing. We think in this county, we think in terms of sidewalks and bike paths as critical transportation projects. Splos 7 passed $4.5 million worth of bike paths. That's three times more money for Splos 7 will be spent on bike paths than will be spent in all of District 4. Less than 1% of Splos 7 goes to District 4, and that's for three intersection improvements around Mr. Bell's house. We need to start thinking about transportation as far as instead of going north and south, going down to Atlanta back up, we need to go east and west. We sit in a beautiful location right next to two of the main corridors of the East Coast, 75 and 85. We need to start thinking how to get there instead of down to Atlanta. Thank you.
Now, what can be done to improve transportation for South Carolina?
Well, the first thing that we have to recognize is this government did exist prior to Mr. Mulrooney losing an animal shelter contract and deciding to run for office. He's been quick to point out that these intersection improvements have somehow been intentionally placed around my home when in fact they were put on the plan by the previous commissioner, David Richard. The government did exist, Mr. Mulrooney. In fact, I added the Cold Mountain intersection to our current SWAT 7 because I recognize there's problems in this community that need to be alleviated. Those are state routes, but also believe we need to step up and do our part. So yes, I did add that to the SWAT 7. But we need to encourage businesses to locate here so that we can generate the revenue to be able to fund these projects without the burden being placed squarely on the shoulders of the homeowners. Thank you.
Support the T-Squads either.
Mr. Mulrooney?
Actually, I was going to point out that Mr. Bell and I did agree on something there, that transportation needs to be about business and getting business here and not necessarily sidewalks and bike paths. So we actually did agree on that point.
Mr. Hubbard?
I don't support these laws either. I don't know anybody that would.
All right, next question, Mr. Meagher will lead off. And I think it's a great segue. Do you intend to work to bring businesses to Forsyth County? And if so, what incentives should be used to bring businesses to the county?
There already are a litany of plans, tax benefits, tax breaks to encourage businesses of different types to come to the county. We need to promote our education system. We need to promote the recreation systems that we have. We need to encourage those businesses to see the amenities that the county offers, and then also, I guess, working through our chamber folks, make sure that the prospective clients clearly understand the tax possibilities and tax breaks that they could get by moving their businesses to the county.
Mr. Morrow?
I don't believe in offering too much incentives as far as bringing business. I do think that we need to get on a vote, that we need to get on a referendum on the ballot as fast as possible to eliminate inventory tax for business. It's the basic Reaganomics. Make it easier for business, then they'll hire people, they expand, they hire people. Those people then start spending money and it contributes to overall economic growth. You know, it's like I said, it's a lesson that we all should have learned from Ronald Reagan. Now we have an opportunity right now. Labor rates in China are going up 15%. Transportation costs are skyrocketing. So companies are starting to figure out, manufacturers are starting to figure out that there's a high cost of having engineering here and manufacturing 10,000 miles away. Companies are moving home. 75% of the top 1,000 companies in the world have representation in Atlanta. We need to drive down the road and get them up here. We need to go down and we need to talk to them and tell them all about Forsyth County. Thank you.
Thank you. It's an interesting question because I have to tell you, anybody that knows me or reads the paper knows that I fight every day to bring businesses to this county. There's nothing that I work on harder than bringing business to Forsyth County. The ad valorem tax exemption that Mr. Mulrooney speaks about, I brought that to the board. I thought that it was important. As soon as the governor signed it, I brought it to the board. I believe that we need to do that to encourage businesses to come to Forsyth County. Mr. Durkee mentioned a committee that was put together that brought 38 issues up to the Board of Commissioners to make it easier to open a business in Forsyth County. I was part of the group. I was the one that worked with the chamber to bring that forward. I created the opportunity zone in District 4 when my fellow commissioners said, it can't be done, we're too wealthy of a community. Folks, it's about results. I have performed, and I will continue to perform for the citizens of this county. And yes, I fully intend on fighting to bring businesses to this county, as I've done every day since I've been in office.
Mr. Hubbard, do you intend to work to bring businesses to Forsyth County? And if so, what incentives should be used to bring businesses to the county?
I appreciate what you've done as far as inventory tax. I believe that's vital to Forsyth County's growth as far as a workplace, work environment, a place that will draw companies here that will manufacture things, and they will have a place to keep them on inventory. Therefore, I know it's been said that it'll cost the county a lot of revenue, but I think if we'll reduce the budgets, take care of the inventory tax, do away with it, these companies that will come to this county will increase our revenue. You'll have folks working, you'll have folks wanting to buy a home, people buying gas, groceries, they'll be buying stuff at the Walmart, just wherever, and I believe that'd be good for the county. I sing time, I'm sorry. But that's the way I feel about it.
We'll let you finish your thoughts, we can mess you up. Yeah, 15 seconds.
I'll go on and I'll carry on, and I know you'll laugh about some of the things I say, but I'm dead serious about the county needing to get a hold of it. And we need to do that. And we need to do it now, not tomorrow, not later. I hear a lot of I want to hear we. That's what I want to hear.
Ms. Mills? And I can repeat the question if you'd like.
Please.
Do you intend to work to bring businesses to Forsyth County? If so, what incentives should be used to bring those businesses to the county?
I'm a large proponent for business. I understand that our tax base is not what it should be, and we can't keep relying on the being a bedroom community. We need to bring in more commercial businesses. In talking to our planning department, I was somewhat surprised that District 4 has had no new zonings in the last 4 years, and I would like to see that changed. I know that a commissioner can't change the economy, but I think that we can do things. I am looking into a fast forward Forsyth program where I would like to try to entice businesses to come by having people work with the business and not and create some of the redundancies that the foolishness, I call it, that is in the UDC we can still have our objectives and have good things, but not have it where we drive people away. We need to be trying to embrace and bring more businesses in.
Mr. Meagher, 30 seconds. Any rebuttal?
I am for the elimination of the business inventory tax. However, 70% of those dollars goes to fund the schools. I'm for the elimination of the tax as soon as a plan is put together that shows how that tax will be not put on the homeowners to fund that 70% of those proceeds to help our schools stay in business.
Mr. Moran?
Actually, I agree that we don't need to pass off the tax revenue to somebody else. A couple things. One, I'm kind of interested that at the Tea Party debate, Cindy, you said that she was in favor of cutting the inventory tax. At the Smart Brothers, she said she's not. And at this one, she's not speaking up. So I'm not sure where she stands on that one. But the Opportunity Zone is actually retail. It's Hammond's Crossing. It's the right idea. It's the wrong place. Retail doesn't provide full-time living wages. And I have a question for Mr. Hubbard. You actually have a business in the Opportunity Zone. Do you take advantage of it? I'm sorry. I'll just leave it at that.
Mr. Bell, 30 seconds.
Thank you. The Opportunity Zone is not just retail. It encompasses the industrial park there as well. And it's for new jobs, hospitality, retail, or manufacturing. And I applaud Ms. Mills on what she wants to do, folks. But again, I'm already doing it. I've already looked to cut the UDC. I've already had a group put together that brought 38 issues to light. As far as the school tax goes, Mr. Meagher, I suggested when we met the first time perhaps you should run for school board. I represent the citizens of Forsyth County. I'm not worried about the school system budget. I have full faith and confidence that they will do it.
Mr. Hogan.
As far as my business, it's usually phone calls and word of mouth. That's the way it's always been all my life. So as far as the county, I mean, folks need stuff and they'll call and we'll deliver. That's just how we've always done.
Ms. Nelson?
To be perfectly clear, I've said the same thing every time about inventory tax. I'm for eliminating any tax, but I'm for eliminating it, not taking it, saying you're eliminating, and really passing it off to the homeowners. And that's what I've said. I've been told by school board members that it's going to create a half a mil increase because they don't have anywhere they can cut. And you can say that it doesn't apply and that's the school board's problem, but each of us are having to pay that tax.
Mr. Moran, you'll be leading off this next question. Do you support the expansion of water and sewer infrastructure to serve the county? And if so, what are your plans for doing so?
Absolutely. We need to be water independent. The fact that we handed $11 million to our vendor this year and the promise that they'll play nice is crazy. I don't like my tax dollars going to a government that I have no representation in. That's called taxation without representation. So yes, we need our own straw. We need our own infrastructure. We need to work with both at the state level with the EPD, and we need to work with at the federal level with the Army Corps of Engineers. We need help from our reps, and we need to expand. And if it takes, either a shared responsibility, but we do, or dropping our own straw in the lake, we need to be independent. We are a county of 175,000+ people. We don't need to buy. We need to pull it ourselves.
Mr. Bell.
Thank you. Just in response to Ms. Mills on the school system can't find a couple of $100,000 out of $258 million budget. I find that absurd with the 20% reduction, which is what I recommend. And on the water and sewer issue, of course, I support growing that system. It needs to be grown based on the demands of where the growth is moving around, as we can afford to do it. We have a tremendous amount of debt in that system that we incurred a couple of years ago, but then we prohibited homes to be put on it. I've never figured that one out. So I would encourage growth either through some type of incentives to get that system used that's already there, and then be able to use those funds to invest in it. Also agree with Mr. Mulrooney, we need a redundant source of water. Saying that we need a straw in the lake, and we need to force the EVD in the core and all that, just really sounds good during a campaign, but it's not fact. But we do need to work on a redundant source.
Mr. Hubbard, do you support the expansion of water and sewer infrastructure to serve the county? And if so, what are your plans for doing so?
Yes, as needed. Right now, the current situation, I believe we're in very good shape.
Are we not?
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. We're in very good shape right now, but in future growth, it's going to come to a time that we'll have to expand it. When we get to that point, that's when we need to start looking to expand it. And if we'll start trying to save money now through cutting budgets and watching what we do and pump money back as a surplus, then when that time comes, we should be ready to be able to move forward instead of waiting till the time we get there, then wanting us, the county, to vote a 1% sales tax to do it again. We need to be putting money back. I mean, that's the only way I've made it through this economic hard time is when it was good, I saved a little money, as most of you have. And what I saved ain't there like it was. But thankfully, it was there to live on. And that's what we need to do with the tax dollars and be able to put it back. I don't know if we can do that. It may be against the law to save money. Well, I mean, I know that's funny.
No, he's
but,
right. You would believe some of the rules we have.
Look at the states.
Ms. Miller, you need to repeat the question. Do you support the expansion of water and sewer infrastructure to serve the county? And if so, what are your plans for doing that?
I would love for our county to be aggressive in figuring out how we can be water independent and working with our state legislators that are willing to work with us to try to figure out a solution that we are not. I don't believe in having that one government can hold another government hostage, and that our citizens are the ones that have to foot the bill for it. I think that we need to, as Mr. Hubbard has said, work together, and we need to find common ground and have a real water and sewer authority that used to exist and have it come back together and it be real and it be viable and it stand for the citizens of the county. I would definitely support that.
Mr. Meagher, just in response to Mr. Bell, yes, I'm very worried about the school system's budget. I think that there's no one in this room that moved here for the great government that Mr. Bell's commissioners have provided. However, there may be many people who moved here because of the good school system. We need our own straw in the creek over there, so to speak, for the water. We do need to reestablish the sewer and water authority, and we need to take the profit moving out of water, let it be its own enterprise zone, and let it fund itself with everybody paying their fair share for the water services in the county. Thanks.
Mr. Roll, 30 seconds.
I just have one more thing about sewer. Sewer is also a very important factor when it comes to drawing business here. You can't get somebody to build a plant that's going to house 200, that's going to employ 200 people without having a sewer line connected to it. So sewer infrastructure needs to be looked at as well to attract business. Thank you.
Mr. Bell?
Well, yes, just to respond to Mr. Meagher, I care a great deal about our schools, and I know that they're part of a quality community, but my obligations to the citizens of Rice County on the Board of Commissioners, and my job is to do what I can to balance our tax digest, to increase revenue, and I believe that a little bit given back to the businesses today will bring much more in returns in the future.
Mr. Hubbard.
I relinquish my time.
Ms. Dills?
Same.
All right. Mr. Meagher, any additional comments?
There is another way to eliminate taxes. You grow out of the taxes. As the economy improves, you don't have to continue to tax the businesses at the same rate. It's a process of growth into it. Instead of cutting taxes and taking it away and putting that tax burden on the homeowners, and I care about the homeowners in the District 4 not having to pay more taxes.
Next question is Mr. Bell. Will the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address precise transportation needs?
Absolutely, it will. I'm not totally supportive of T-SPLOST. I recognize it's difficult to admit, but I recognize that we have to fund these projects. The fact of T-SPLOST is it will perform a great number of projects here in the county, and the 25% of what we pay in will come back to the county to be used in as how we see fit. So, yeah, the passage of failure does have some impact because then we'll have to look at things like SPLOST and what transportation projects were put on that list, and then how do we fund those that T-SPLOST is currently projected to fund. So it's a serious issue, and those projects do have to be funded. I'm just not sure T-SPLOST is the right vehicle, but it will definitely make an impact.
Mr. Hubbard, do you need me to repeat the question? Will the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address the Forsyth County's transportation needs?
Well, I understand what Mr. Bell has said, but also realize that we don't need to fully rely on another tax increase. As all of you know, anytime a penny's passed, it never leaves. The toll road, a fine example, and as soon as this is over with, we're taking it up. As soon as it come and it was time for it to be over with, they went to squeal, and it's still there. Same way with this T-SPLOST. I realize it would be nice for the county to have to do some road improvements, but also realize if it ever passes, it'll be there forever and we'll never be rid of it. We need to rely on our own sales to do what we have money to do with. So, thank you.
Ms. Mills, would you like to repeat the question?
No. I recently attended the GDOT in conjunction with the Chamber. I can't remember, they didn't call it a T-SPLOST pep rally, but it was essentially, it was informative of all the projects that were existing and what they were going to do and why this was important. And I asked the question there, I submitted the question, and they happened to do it, is, well, what happens in the 400 corridor? We have, it's like a $78 million project, but there's only $48 million to go toward that funding. And where is that additional money going to come from? And Todd Long answered that a certain percent, that they couldn't say exactly, but 95% was going to come from the federal government. Well, see, that worries me, because I don't see the federal government having a lot of money. And it worries me that to get the project done, then it's going to fall on the back eventually of the taxpayer. Fine. And so I don't support it, and I think we can figure out another way.
Mr. Meagher, would the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address Forsyth County's transportation needs?
I think that whether the T-SPLOST passes or fails, we're really not going to see much difference, except for the fact if it does pass, which is going to cost a penny more for everything that we purchase inside the county. So I don't think that we'll be in any different shape, whether it passes or not, except for the pocketbook issue. I concur with most of the other panel here that once you put that penny tax on, it's going to be on for the rest of for eternity. I think we would be better served by trying to handle our own transportation issues through SPLOST and through other kinds of methods like that. There are serious transportation issues. I do recognize that. Thanks.
Mr. Mulrooney, do you need me to repeat the question?
Yeah, go ahead, because we turned into T-SPLOST, but thanks.
Will the success or failure of T-SPLOST impact how you address Forsyth County's transportation needs?
The passage of T-SPLOST is scary. As others have pointed out, the difference between the amount of, we just saw a presentation last night, several people in this room just went to a presentation last night, the difference between the project's cost that they're projecting on T-SPLOST and the amount of revenue they're projecting is in the billions. billions of dollars short on the amount of projects that will have to be made, will have to be built out, but they're not projecting the revenue to build them. So yeah, they, it will definitely change. I think in District 4, I may be mistaken, but I believe in District 4, the only thing in my neck of the woods that we get is a crosswalk and jet them down to 400. You know, really a high place there for foot traffic. You know, the T-Splos, our representatives for T-Splos were a one of the commissioners from the southern part of the county and the mayor. So it gives you an idea of the projects on.
Mr. Bell, 30 seconds, respond. Mr. Hubbard, anything
additional? Now, most of all the T-Splos have seen, if you'll look, it says proposed. In other words, ain't none of it chiseled in stone what they're going to do once this passes. And that's what scares me better, worse than anything, because it ain't none of it chiseled in stone. They've just got it out there sort of like a pretty piece of candy for a child for folks to vote on. And that's what bothers me, misrepresentation.
It bothers me when we are asked to reward government for not doing a good job by giving them another penny. I think that it comes a time you got to grind your feet in. You got to say no. You got to do it with what you have, and you need to figure out a way to make it work better.
Mr. Morey,
adopted.
Okay. Next question, Mr. Cover, would you leave it off? What do you believe is the best way to facilitate infrastructure improvements in Forsyth County?
Best what?
Well, we talked about, obviously, the candidates that are comfortable with a sales tax. So what do you think is the best way to facilitate those infrastructure improvements?
Well, there's some that, you know, where we see a need, I believe, we need to sit down and try to find a solution. Instead of just jumping on something. I believe we need to find a solution for it. And I know these SPLOS, which is their name, which everyone knows that when SPLOS is up, it will be voted back in, naturally. It's going to be, because they never go away. I've never seen one go away yet, and I'm not that old. So I know that it will come up another day, and when it does, that's when we need to start, we can start doing our infrastructure. That's not too many years off before it comes up again. So, I mean, that's the way I'm looking at it right now. And we can still do it with revenue and balancing things and getting things trimmed down. I just caught you out of the corner of my eye. This balancing things and getting things trimmed down to where we can manage our own. I've always had to manage what I've done with what I have made, and that's the way we always done things, in a very fine manner. And I think the county can do the same thing.
Ms. Mills, what do you think is the best way to facilitate infrastructure?
Up until this SPLOS, I had always supported SPLOS because it was a way, at the time we were growing so fast, that it was the best means of being able to provide parks for road improvements. But then as the years have went by, I've been a little troubled sometimes by, I didn't vote for this SPLOS because it wasn't time to vote on it. I didn't like that we were having a special election and it was costing the county $45,000 or $50,000 to have an election that it didn't even run out until 2013. I feel like that if we have SPLOS projects, that they need to be really needed projects. In my district, Hopewell Road, the roundabout, I did not think and do not think that I've been going through there all my life and I've never been more than two back. And I don't think we should just create projects to spend SPLOS dollars. I think that we're better off to really analyze and see what we need and to work together as a community to make it happen if it's needed.
After we've determined that facilities or infrastructure needs to be improved, there's really only two ways that I know that it can be funded. One is a bond issue and the other is a sales tax. That I believe that's the only two methods that are available to the Board of Commissioners. bond issue is like a mortgage. You can borrow $300,000 and over 20 years pay back a total of $900,000. Sales tax, and that's all put on, the bond issue is pretty much put on the homeowner and on the property tax. Sales tax at least gives the opportunity for everybody who buys things within the county, whether they own a home or not, it provides them the opportunity to help fund those infrastructure, or those facilities that we have predetermined that we truly need. And that, I'm stressing that because that's a very, very important part, whether we really need it or not.
Mr. Moore?
Boy, infrastructure is such a large, broad subject, or such a large term, I guess. You know, I'm a big Dave Ramsey guy. If you can't, I hate debt. If you can't pay for it in cash, you can't afford it. But that's not really reasonable in government. So we get into situations where, SPLOST 7 is, or SPLOST projects, those are projects that we're saying this is what we need to do for the next 6 years, but are they really that critical? What happens when things comes up? Keeping a reserve fund is good. Things like water and sewer, which is probably, I think, our largest, and Mr. Belton probably answered this, is probably our largest debt is in the water and sewer, but those actually are revenue generators. So they pay themselves back. You pay for those services, so we can use things like the Public Facilities Authority to bond. I approve of the Public Facilities Authority because the idea of that is that you only bond projects that are self-sustaining, that are they pay themselves back by the simple project. So, but other than that, I'm really against debt. But sometimes you have to live in the world.
Mr. Bell.
Thank you. I'd just like to point something out a little bit about SPLOST and T-SPLOST, and that my opponent, Ms. Mills, doesn't support it this time around. But yet, the previous SPLOST and the green space bond that she made $120,000 off of in personal commissions, she supported. I think that's interesting that she now wants to cut government spending, and I guess that's when she can't make money off of it. On the infrastructure needs, we have to fund those. They're going to come from the general fund through the property ad valorem taxes. They're going to come from SPLOST. I've always supported using SPLOST for its intended use, which is for infrastructure and capital needs, not as a pork barrel checkbook for more and more expensive amenities. We have to be responsible about what we're doing, and the roads and bridges and water and sewer are very, very important issues to us. And the fact of the matter is they're going to have to be paid for. Now, we don't know what that funding mechanism is, but I have to continue to invest in our community.
Mr. Hubbard, can you rebut?
I'll relinquish my time over to Sandy. Is that correct?
Mr. Bell knows that I sell real estate. He knows that when I sold the land to the county for a park on Eccles Road, that I did everything the county attorney told me to do. He has substantiated that himself on the Focus on Forsyth blog. I did make money on that one deal. I did not have a vote in that. It did not come before the Park and Rec Board. I've tried to be real upfront and honest about it. I've done everything that I need to do or was told to do.
Mr. Meagher. Mr. Mulrooney.
Well, I have to disagree. I've got a collection of emails between Ms. Mills and the former chairman talking about this purchase and how to get it presented to the board. It didn't go through the process that the board had set up. And on the Focus on Forsyth, she talked about a $50,000 commission, but she neglected to mention the other $69,000 that she made on a secondary purchase.
Our final question for this group. When do you believe commissioners should accept the recommendations of county staff regarding vendors, and when is it appropriate to not accept those recommendations? What criteria will you use in considering whether to support the recommendations of county staff regarding vendors? Ms. Mills?
I think that we have county staff in place that are supposed to be experts in their field, and that most of us are not born to be experts in all fields. I know that we have some that think they are. I think that we try to listen to our staff, and if we don't have staff that is meeting those obligations or fulfilling those obligations, then they need to be replaced. I think think that when you reach a point where decisions constantly, repeatedly are being made that are enhancing the lives of campaign contributors, and that staff is being overlooked and ignored and ridiculed and showing such little respect, that's when you have a real problem. And I think that our county employees deserve to have the respect of their commissioners, and they need to be talked to and treated with respect.
Mr. Meagher. I have a long history of hiring the best people to work in the areas that I was responsible for, and then letting those best people make recommendations to do what needed to be done in the areas of their expertise. I believe in hiring the best staff in the county. I believe in following their recommendations, unless there is someone who has specific knowledge that is superior to what the staff does have. And in that case, I need to hire that person and put them on staff. Thank you.
Mr. Mulrooney?
I've had more than one commissioner and as commissioner tell me that Forsyth County staff make them look good. My limited experience with our county staff, we have some great people, some quality professional people. If you feel the need to constantly question or second guess or micromanage them, then one of you is in the wrong job. You know, this is a very loaded question, and I'm not going to do it. So I'll leave it at that.
Commissioner Bell.
Thank you. And Mr. Mulrooney is correct. We have a great staff here at Forsyth County. We have probably the best staff in North Georgia, and I have a great relationship with many of them, and I respect them a great deal. Out of the number of decisions that we have to make, you will maybe see one or two a year that come up that a commissioner may not agree with. And folks, it boils down to the simple fact that I'm elected to represent the citizens of this county. I'm not elected to follow the government bureaucrats, and I'm not going to. If I see something's wrong, or if I feel something's wrong, and I'm not getting a satisfactory answer, I'm not going to roll over. I'm going to keep pushing at it because I have your interest at heart, and it's your checkbook. My decisions are always based on what's in the best long-term interest of Forsyth County and citizens. And the campaign issue that's trying to be made is one decision out of the hundreds we make a year. And folks, we have a great staff, but don't expect me to follow the government bureaucrats because I'm not.
Mr. Hubbard?
I know and realize that the staff's very good, but I believe if I'm a representative of the people of the 4th District, I owe them that I need to look over the paperwork myself and be familiar with it. And if there's something I don't understand, have the staff inform me of it, and that way I can make a answer for myself instead of using somebody else's information. I mean, it may take a little more time, but I trust my own decisions, and that's why I always like to have people, if they've got stuff there, let me look at it. Show me why, show me the reason why, and let me look at the numbers. Then I feel comfortable in voting yes or no on the issues. That way I can give that's what the people deserve, is representation. And they're missing out on a lot of that.
Ms. Nelson, you're both.
I agree with what Mr. Hubbard's saying. I think it's the duty and the obligation of the commissioner to be in touch with his constituents and to know the issues prior to going into a room and voting on it. I think they need to understand and have a good knowledge that they don't just trust another commissioner, but that they look at it and find out and seek answers to questions about it.
Meagher, your rebuttal. Mr.
Moore? No, I'll leave it.
Ms. Stroke? All right, well, we are at our closing statement time. Again, we'll start on the side of the room. Each candidate has a minute and a half. Ms. Miller?
I just want to take a moment to thank each of you for coming tonight. I feel bad and guilty of taking up so much of my supporters' times, but I'm so grateful that you come, and I just want to tell you that I will serve the people in District 4 with honesty. I will serve you with respect. I will work hard to do all that I can to make our community even better. I love Forsyth County. I love serving people, and I hope and pray that you will vote for me on July 31st.
The incumbent claims credit for lowering taxes, lowering the budget by 25%. But all he and the other four commissioners did was not change the millage rate over the last 7 years. The Board of Tax Assessors determined that property values decreased by 25%. And with no action by the commissioners, the budget reflected that 25% reduction. That's the results. And I'm a member of the Board of Tax Assessors. I attended a small college in northern Alabama where I earned a bachelor's degree. I earned a teaching certificate from the University of Alabama, Birmingham. I have a graduate degree from Georgia State University. I worked hard for my education, and that hard work paid off in important job assignments throughout my career. My career in the school business and in the military and as an elected official represents a lifetime of working in and with various governments. I know how to listen to constituents. I do not believe in bullying or bombast. I believe in personal thrift and public thrift. And my friends will tell you that I'm frugal with my own money, and I'll be frugal with yours too. My leadership and team building and teamwork makes me uniquely qualified to represent District 4 and all of Forsyth County as a commissioner for District 4 and support the school board too. The incumbent cautions against electing friends and relatives to this office, and I concur with him. I hope you'll look closely at the qualifications of each candidate and will vote for the person who has proven track record in leadership, service, and experience. Thank you.
Mr. Morgan?
I too want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. I really appreciate you taking your time. Oh, thank you. They'll probably hear me anyway. I am unique on this panel. I'm just a normal conservative homeowner in District 4 that happens to believe that our founding fathers had the right idea, that normal people should step forward and serve the community. Now, I have a small 0.6-acre lot with my home on it. I've never had property in conservation use, and I actually receive a property tax bill, which, while that may sound like no big deal, two of my opponents, according to tax records, don't even own property in this county. Yet they're asking you for their trust to own your money, and they don't even have any skin in the game. I am the only candidate that is not part of the good old boy power structure that took $16 million of our property tax this year and gave it to the city of Cumming. Giving our property tax to a government that we have no voice in is called taxation without representation. And we did. We fought a war for that one. Here, it's business as usual. I'll give you a prime example of what I'm talking about. When little 90-pound Nydia Tisdale here was bullied at Cumming City Hall a couple of months ago, only two candidates in this county had the audacity to voice their displeasure with this violation of citizens' rights. One was Dennis Brown, the other was me. Those folks in the City Hall don't scare me, and apparently they don't scare the Colonel either. It is time for the citizens of Forsyth County to take ownership of their community and their money. Now I'm going to give you a real quick, easy way to remember me. I'm not one of the good old boys. I'm the completely different candidate. So when you get to that list, fine. Go straight to the bottom, vote none of the above, vote Bill.
Thank you, Ethan. And again, thank you to the GOP for having this forum. My re-election campaign revolves around my record. Not empty campaign promises, not rhetoric, not sound bites. It's about results, real, verifiable results. My record shows real results and real solutions to the real issues of concern to the citizens of this county. I have a record of reducing spending, reducing red tape and bureaucracy. I have a record of protecting private property rights, protecting businesses, encouraging businesses. My record, again, shows verifiable results. I hope you'll visit my website. That's www.teambell.org. Or you can call me. Nydia will have it on YouTube here. Thank you, Nydia. 678-648-6130. That's my home number. When you go to the polls on July 31st, just remember, results matter, and I've delivered real results. Thank you for your time, and I do humbly ask for your vote.
Thank you.
We'd like to take this opportunity to thank everyone for coming. Thank y'all for hosting this. I think it's good that we get to hear everybody's side. I'm one that I graduated from South County High. didn't go to college, but I have been in the School of Hard Knocks of small business. I ain't gonna say I've graduated yet because it's an on learning, it's continuous. You never graduate from it, you adjust. And I've adjusted over the past 3 or 4 years. As far as the property tax, I believe he may be referring to myself or my home's at, because my grandfather, who is almost 98, gave me land to build a house. And it's deeded and he's got it. And I'm not gonna argue with that. I'm very thankful that I had a grandfather that allowed me and gave me a piece of property there. I realize I don't pay the tax, but it gets paid. It gets paid, I assure you, all taxes get paid. That's why it's not recorded, because in respect to my grandfather, I'm fine with that, wouldn't you be? I believe I am. But as far as this camp, I love the camp. And I'll work to keep the county at a balanced point to where it's not overbalanced, that it's not going over. I ain't took no money from nobody because I don't want nobody coming up to me and saying, hey, I helped you, I need a favor. So that's how come I've not raised a lot of money. It's just come out of my pocket. So thank you very much. Hope you vote for us July 31st.
Thank you all. This has been very enjoyable, and we appreciate you again for putting your hat in the ring. We're going to take about a 5-minute break.